Louisiana Eats is brought to you with major support from Zatarain's, a New Orleans tradition since 1889. WWNO New Orleans and our studios in the Southern Food and Beverage Museum, this is Louisiana Eats. I'm Poppy Tooker. It's holiday time in Louisiana, and that means parties, lots of parties. On this week's show, we're going to help you get ready with some great advice from the pros. Master mixologist Adam Seger does some magic tricks with vermouth. Then, Shreveport's Aulden Morgan gives our roving reporter, Chris J, a shot of something pretty shocking. And we'll also hear from a most unusual cocktailian, ordained Catholic priest, Father Bill Dailey, who gives us a spiritual look behind the bar. Let's get this party started on this week's Louisiana Eats. At the cocktail party of my dreams, Adam Seger would be the star mixologist. Adam's ability to expertly pair cocktails with culinary innovations and with the latest exhibits at the Art Institute of Chicago makes him one of the most creative forces in today's spirits industry. I had the opportunity to talk with Adam about his vision for curating cocktails and also taste his latest creation, Balsam Amaro, a versatile vermouth unlike any you've ever had.
Well, the Art Institute of Chicago is not only one of the greatest museums in the world, but it's also one of the most progressive in their outreach into the community. So the museum does all kinds of events from After Dark, which they bring in 1,200 young people late at night in the museum with DJs and art installations and cocktails, to all kinds of galas that are the openings to the exhibits and the artists that are being featured at the museum. So I am most honored and privileged to be the mixologist who creates the cocktails for these events.
I think it's very almost common now for people to think of pairing cocktails with food. When you go and pair cocktails with art, how do you approach that, Adam?
Well, I've really just delve into the artists and not only looking at the pieces that they present, what the curator at the Art Institute of Chicago decided to display, but also what was that artist's background? What influenced them? Where did they live? What other artists were their mentors, or what were they doing that was completely original? Which is generally the ones coming to the Art Institute are the ones who are creating a style of art that's never been done before. And from there, I then create my cocktail, which most recently was Charles Ray, the sculptor, who is still very much alive and producing some of the most world-class pieces of art around the world. And so I did a very architectural cocktail for the opening of his exhibit and began with a Japanese ice tower, this very kind of architectural contraption that I had ice on top, and then it had black limes and dried lemons and an infusing chamber in the middle. And I was pouring Sauvignon Blanc and Balsam Amaro and spirit and letting those flow through those beautiful dried fruits. And then it comes through this crazy Willy Wonka looking thing that could be a still or it could be something out of Breaking Bad. You wouldn't really know. But at the bottom of it, all of a sudden, a cocktail comes out. And it was accompanied by a living wall by Sage Living Gardens, which actually had fresh herbs coming out of the bar. And it became a very interactive cocktail, because part of Charles Ray's sculpture is a little bit about disrupting the norm and having someone be a bit shocked by the piece and interacting with it and looking at it from different angles. And so the guests not only came up and got the cocktail and saw this piece of working sculpture, but they picked their own herbs, slapped their own herbs, and garnished their own cocktail. And so they became part of the art of the cocktail. And to me, that's really where the soul of what I try and do at the Art Institute, of just taking the surreal, sublime experience of seeing great art up close, but to augment that with a cocktail that's inspired by the same artists. I think it just transports you to a new place that I think is really unique to what we're doing in Chicago and as just as exciting as possible, and a great reason for you to visit that city up north whenever you have a chance.
You just pulled out one of the most beautiful bottles of anything I've ever seen in my life. What is that you've got to show us today?
So this is an American Amaro. Amaro is a bittersweet liqueur that goes all the way back to the mid-18th century when all your medicine was really derived from botanicals and roots and spices that were steeped in distilled spirit. A balsam is a healing and a nurturing and a restorative elixir. So kind of think of everything that would be in vermouth except for the wine, and that's in balsam. Wormwood and dried fruit and spices and teas.
If there's no wine, what's the base?
Well, the base is a 151 proof potato vodka. It's just a very beautiful neutral spirit. It's made at Boyd & Blair Distillery. They ferment the local potatoes with champagne yeast. It's hand distilled in a copper pot still. The bottles are made right next to the distillery. The distillery is next to a stream. It's just very idyllic. And we use that as a canvas for botanicals that we get from Roderick Marcus at Rare Tea Cellar. He's a master tea blender who blends the teas that are steeped into the spirit, but also direct imports cardamom from a biodynamic estate in India and spices direct from all over the world. And of course, wormwood, which is the most important botanical in a vermouth.
So how did you come up with this idea? Why are you making balsam?
Well, we really wanted to do something disruptive in the vermouth segment of the industry. Vermouth is really at an absolute renaissance right now, predominantly because of the Manhattan, the Negroni, the Martinez, that now these cocktails are coming back and they're so in vogue, you can't make them without vermouth. But because vermouth has not been understood, because it's, is it a spirit? Is it a wine? What is it? And vermouth really is about 75% wine. Unfortunately, a lot of times it's treated like a spirit, and a bottle's half open, it sits on a bar for 6 months or 2 years, and you open it up and just absolutely as awful as a bottle of wine that had been open a few months.
Mm.
So we wanted to kind of tip it on its head and started with the spirit being infused instead of the wine, and then a beautiful rustic cane sugar that goes in there to balance the bitterness and the wormwood. And instead of adding the wine ourselves, we put in a bottle at 88 proof and let the bartender, the mixologist, the restaurateur, the home cook, the cocktail enthusiast choose a wine that they like to drink. And they simply put three parts of wine, one part of balsam, and voila, they have fresh, bespoke, personalized vermouth. And they can mix as much or little as they like, so they always have that beautiful, fresh vermouth experience.
That's incredible. That's never been done before, has it?
Not in 250 years. So we're kind of flipping it on its head. It's been called groundbreaking by Forbes. We've got some beautiful feedback that is just kind of heartwarming.
Well, speaking of heartwarming, let's warm our hearts by tasting this beautiful stuff.
Absolutely.
So first, of course, any tasting begins with the nose. Oh my goodness. It is so aromatic.
Well, you've got a group of kind of three different types of botanicals in there. The first I call your European herbs, and those are wormwood and fennel and elderflower, both medicinal in their absorption, but also very aromatic, particularly the elderflower. The wormwood is really more for kind of a bitter counterbalance.
Mm-hmm.
Wormwood, very, very high in antioxidants, extremely healthy. And that's actually where the word vermouth came from. It was derived from vermut. And in fact, in Europe, you cannot sell vermouth if it doesn't have wormwood in it. But we're trying to bring it back to that tradition of vermouth, and we wanted to be true to the respect and the origin of where vermouth came from. So once you smell those herbs, and then also you're going to smell some teas, and then finish it off with what I call grandma spices. And that's everything from single origin vanilla and clove and cardamom and cinnamon. And that's what's combining what you're smelling.
I think this would be a really great way to warm up.
If you have one thing to put in your flask, I would recommend always carrying a little bit of balsam because it's so versatile. You can have it with a little bit of ginger beer or tonic water and simply as an aperitif like that. Last night, we were making cocktails at Brennan's with my good friend Lou Brow, and a little bit of Nicholas Filliott Brut Champagne, some chilled balsam on there, an orange Swiss, and it was an instant, elegant champagne cocktail.
Ooh, there's something on the bottle that mentions that that cocktail you would call the royal wisdom.
Yes, absolutely. And just literally as simple as 3/4 ounce of balsam and some good champagne. or just drinking it as a vermouth. Now, vermouth, if you go to Spain and Italy in the summertime and you go to an outdoor cafe, half the people are all drinking vermouth on the rocks. And you would never think of that in the States because, unfortunately, a lot of the vermouth is oxidized. It's been open too long. But a freshly opened bottle of vermouth is just magical.
Well, Adam, once again, you have created magic in a bottle. So thank you so much for bringing that magic to us here at Louisiana Eats.
Well, it is my pleasure, and it's been fun drinking it. And I couldn't be more excited to see what the chefs in Louisiana do with making their own vermouth and bringing vermouth in the kitchen.
Adam Seger, mixologist in residence at the Art Institute of Chicago and creator of Balsam Amaro. As the cocktail scene in Shreveport-Bossier continues expanding, so does the innovation behind bars. For years, bartender Aulden Morgan at Zocolo Neighborhood Eatery in Shreveport has been transforming their cocktail menu into one of the most unique in the region, offering drinks with fresh and local juices and a diverse array of quirky infused liquors.
Go ahead and just lead the way here.
The Louisiana Eats crew dropped by Zocolo one weekday afternoon to meet Aulden and try a sampling of his latest libations. So at this time, the craft cocktail scene is really sort of in its infancy here in Shreveport, as I understand it. So when people come into the bar here and order drinks from you, are you finding them surprised? Or are they... do they think it's time for a gin and tonic and you sort of turn them around? What happens?
It's usually kind of a turnaround thing. Like they'll order something, or we have a really nice patio out, so we have a lot of people that sit on the patio, and I'll be like, well, I'll try something fresh like cucumber with your gin and tonic or something like that, or a little bit of ginger, or I'll try this new cocktail that I've been wanting to get out there and kind of see how people like. It's always kind of an experience to see what they would go out kind of outside of their box, and I kind of go outside of my box at the same time with the customer. It's always hit and miss, add a little bit more of this, add a little less than this. It's always a learning experience behind a cocktail.
Tell us about some of the creations that you have come up with. What are some of the surprising cocktails for the Shreveport scene?
We have a great new craft beer here in Shreveport. It's called a Great Raft. And I'm friends with a lot of those guys, and we kind of were the first people to have their beer on tap, and I figured it'd be really cool to do a beer cocktail with their beer and do kind of what we do here, too. The first one I did was Cathead Vodka. It's kind of pecan in flavor, and they had a really nice Saison out at the time that kind of had that lemon honey flavor to it, and I thought pecan and lemon and honey would go really well together, and kind of just shook that up and added a little bit of that Saison on top of it, and it really went together really well. Then next after that would probably be an Artini competition that we do every year here in Shreveport or Bossier at the Horseshoe Casino. And it's kind of just a martini competition of who has the most different or most delicious martini. And started to kind of go out of the box with that. And for some reason I fought dandelions and thought I shot myself in the foot on that one, as it's so hard to find dandelions. And but I ended up meeting a couple of people who that forage and stuff like that, and thought it'd be a really cool idea, and that one really turned out to be good too. So just trying to...
What did you infuse the dandelions in? What did you do? How did you make the drink?
Well, we roasted them for a little while, kind of give them like a little nutty flavor, because dandelions have a lot of different flavors actually. The root kind of tastes like real earthy, like a mushroom or a truffle or something, and then the leaves trying to be a honeysuckle flavor to them. So I just kind of mixed it with local honey to try to add onto that nuttiness. And just made a simple syrup out of it, kind of boiled them down and added sugar, equal parts sugar and water, and a little bit of honey to kind of give it that extra little dimension.
Well, Aulden, would you take us in the back and show us some of the science experiments you're cooking up back there?
Yeah, I sure can. We actually have a new cocktail list about to come out, so there's a lot of things back there right now we're working on.
Well, let's go see. Sitting on two shelves, dozens of jars and bottles were filled with infusions in a variety of colors. Amber, peach, yellow, and brown.
Always something new. I have a peanut butter infused bourbon that I just infuse our well bourbon with. It's actually, it's not a bad bourbon for a well. It's a great bourbon, but I wanted to add a little bit of flavor to it. I had a, there's a New Orleans cocktail that I really love, and it's called a brandy milk punch. So I use a peanut butter bourbon and trying to give it more of a dessert feel. We use whole milk and white creme de coco, trying to give it a little chocolate flavor. We do a ginger infused vodka, which we're on the shelf right now. We use that one for a kind of an Asian pear and ginger, real sweet martini, kind of like a lemon drop, but with just pears and ginger. We have orange infused vodka. It only takes the skin of an orange too on that one. I do a lot of my stuff with skins because either you're gonna get too sweet or the vodka will kind of get this dusty taste after a while. If you use just all of the fruit, you use the skin, it's easy to strain out. You just get the flavor of the fruit without all the bitterness. We start orange, lavender, cucumber, vanilla, all sorts of stuff. Rosemary simple syrup, we use in our tea. Asian pear simple syrup for that pear martini I was telling you about.
On the bottom shelf, one bottle stood out to me. The only one that came with its own warning label written in Sharpie. It's hot. This, Alden explained, was the Carolina Reaper vodka.
That Carolina Reaper pepper is one of the hottest pepper in the world right now.
Yeah, it exceeded the ghost pepper in heat.
Over twice as hot on the Scoville unit as a ghost pepper, so. Carolina Reaper pepper, it only takes about 2 to 3 hours to sit in vodka. It's actually the quickest infusion we do here. The pepper's just so hot, it really only takes about a third of a pepper to make about a gallon of it, too.
And where do you get those peppers from?
I had to special order them from there's a handful of people that grow them in Carolina where it originated from. The last batch I bought, I actually got from Australia.
Wow.
Tried to figure out a way to just wow factor, and that was my first kind of infusion that I ever did. And I was like, that'd be great for a Bloody Mary, and then it ended up people taking bets behind the bar of who didn't drink it or how hot the Bloody Mary was. And
it wouldn't make sense to visit Zocolo without sampling their most famous item on the menu. But I have to admit I had my reservations.
I'm not going to play.
Poppy, come on. Poppy, definitely.
This looks like a boys' game to me. I'm not playing.
I get forced to take them all the time. People will dare it, and they'll be like, well, if the bartender's not going to do one, I'm definitely not going to do one.
Fortunately, our fearless roving reporter Chris J was on hand and agreed to join Alden in a shot of the potent liquid.
Is this in the vein of what doesn't kill you makes you better?
I would say so, yes.
I'm not even going to give you a full shot because I don't want to kill you.
Tell me, will you tell me what exactly I'm in for here? I mean, how much pain is...
You're in for about a good solid 5 minutes of just heat in your...
Okay, Chris. Don't worry.
Just down the hatch, right, Alden?
We're here to back you up if anything bad happens.
Just get it down.
I'm afraid I'm going to do it and you're not going to do it.
I mean, I'll do it.
Okay, all right. On three. Right. One, two, three.
All right.
Cheers. Oh, my God.
I don't be surprised if you can't talk.
But it's a really deep, searing pain.
Here come the hiccups for me.
But you're getting a little flushed. You're looking a little flushed.
Yeah. It hurts like hell.
Is the pain moving down your esophagus?
Yes. And that's actually really the part that hurts. My mouth is not that bad, but my esophagus feels like it needs to be replaced. I feel like you only live once, and when else? I'm never going to drink another ghost or Carolina Reaper pepper infused vodka. I'm never going to have that chance again. So I figured I'd do it. But God, I'm in pain.
At least we didn't do a whole one.
Bartender Aulden Morgan and our roving reporter Chris J at Zocolo Neighborhood Eatery in Shreveport. You know that old joke? A priest goes into a bar? Well, when we come back from a short break, we're actually going behind the bar with Father Bill Dailey, one of the most virtuous cocktailians you'll ever meet. Stay tuned. I'm Poppy Tooker, and you're listening to Louisiana Eats, edible content for Louisiana food lovers. Louisiana Eats is brought to you with major support from Popeye's Louisiana Kitchen and Zatarain's.
I am Father Bill Dailey of the Congregation of Holy Cross, which is a group of priests founded in France in the 19th century and in the United States, primarily known for having founded the University of Notre Dame. I teach in the law school there, and I am the rector of an undergraduate residence hall.
Father Bill Dailey is no ordinary priest. Aside from his law degree and tenured position as Notre Dame professor, Father Bill finds himself in the unique position of being the esteemed clergyman to a community of craft cocktail innovators. With his singular perspective on the connection between spirituality and spirits, Father Dailey has become the moral backbone of the Apprentice or CAP program at Tales of the Cocktail in New Orleans. We were graced with the opportunity to sit down with Father Bill during Tales of the Cocktail to discuss living a virtuous life behind the bar. Father Bill, we're so happy to have this opportunity to speak with you on Louisiana Eats. How in the world do you come to be involved with Tales of the Cocktail, and how did you get chosen to be in the Cocktail Apprentice Program?
I often say that if I am not the luckiest person in the world, I can't wait to meet who is, because they must have really great stories to tell. But mine has some logic to it. So I teach in the law school at Notre Dame, and to teach in a law school, my view is you should practice law. So I went to law school as a priest in order to get ready to do some work teaching or administrating at the University of Notre Dame. And after law school, I clerked for a federal judge. Then I practiced at a regular big corporate law firm in Washington, D.C. for a couple of years, where I met a fellow named Derek Brown. His girlfriend at the time had a bar called the Tabard Inn, where she made beautiful craft cocktails on Wednesday and Thursday nights. I was introduced to this place and to Chantal by a colleague of mine at the law firm. Derek came in one night and said, "Chantal tells me you're a priest. I would like to finish my Catholic initiation. Can you help me?" So on Sunday mornings, Derek would come to my parish. I would talk over then Father Ratzinger's book, Introduction to Christianity, written back in 1967, I think. We would chat about the Catholic faith, and he would say, "Hey, I'm opening this speakeasy tonight. You should come by." Or, "A group of us are planning a repeal day party in December. Would you be on the planning committee with us?" Or, "We elected you chaplain to the D.C. Craft Cocktail Bartender Association." I said, "What are my duties?" "Well, as far as I could tell, you keep coming to our bars and we charge you less." It seemed like a good deal to me. So I joke with Derek that I tried to save his soul and he has tried to destroy my liver. May one of us succeed. Hopefully the right one.
That's something. So you get this induction into the craft cocktail world by just showing up.
That's
by
right.
Just being there. And when did you first hear about Tales of the Cocktail and this opportunity?
When I moved to Notre Dame in South Bend, you might imagine that there are fewer craft cocktail bars in South Bend.
Yes.
And you would not be wrong. And so I didn't get to see my friends nearly as much. So once again, through the good offices of Derek Brown, he called me up. He said, "You know, we need to find a way to get you to Tales of the Cocktail." So we conspired to put together a panel for 2012 Tales called The Spirit of Spirits. And we talked about the intersection of religion and alcohol, which, as I'm sure you would imagine, goes back to as early as there was alcohol. There was religion and there was alcohol. And as the psalm says in Psalm 104, "He gives us wine to gladden our hearts." And so that has always brought people closer to God. And we did a panel about that. It was reasonably well received. And my friend Don Lee said, "You know, I think it would be good for the CAP program if you would come and hang out with us." And that's not an offer you turned down. So
no, that's pretty
that was 3 years ago. So this is the third year of hanging out with the CAPs. I've done some talks for them. Mostly my job is to be present to them. You know, a priest and a bartender both share what we call in the caring professions, right? And so these hospitality professionals care for their guests and they care for one another in a way that is impressive and moving to me. And I suppose there's a kind of symbiosis in these friendships where they help me to be a better priest. And I hope at least at the margins, I can help them to think about hospitality a little bit differently.
I am really, really so impressed by this because I'll be honest with you, Father Bill, the CAPS program was the last place in the world I expected to find a priest because
when I usually hear about what the Caps are up to, it's usually more about drunken debacles and sexcapades. And so I was thinking, well, how does Father Bill fit into that scene? It goes all night. It's kind of wild. Do you ever find their behaviors self-conscious in any way because suddenly they're hanging with a priest?
I hope they're not self-conscious. And just in my experience, they are not. I would say that while I have heard those same stories for the most part, and certainly right up front, they're presented to me as a priest. I wear my Roman collar on the first day when they're presented with their jackets, their red coats as the new caps. There's a PowerPoint presentation. It says, if you need help or advice in the kitchen, you go to Mike Ryan, who wears a white coat. If you need help with overall logistics, you go to Don Lee, who wears a white coat. If you need to know what's going on in the liquor room, you go to Chris DeLavi, who wears a white coat. And if you're having trouble with your roommate, if you're not sleeping well, if you overindulged, you can talk to Father Bill.
And so that's wonderful.
They present me as someone that they have brought in because they care about the human dimension of folks. And they want people to be responsible and to take care of themselves. And so I think there has been a move with tales growing and becoming so important to the industry to emphasize not just the wilder side of things, but also balance and the idea, as Robert Simonson from the New York Times, I brought him out to talk to my undergraduates at Notre Dame about virtue and alcohol. And he said to them that his mother, who just died last year, drank an old-fashioned every day, and Robert, in her honor, drinks one every Friday, and he wants to do that when he's 65 and 75 and 85, should he make it there. And so I think there's an emphasis now in the CAP program to make sure that these folks can sustain a career for the long haul. And that has to do with a little less debaucherousness, I suppose. If I heard confessions, I couldn't tell you. But I have neither been a part of nor witnessed any sexcapades. That's all I can tell you on that score. I joke sometimes with my fellow priests at Notre Dame who aren't quite sure what I'm coming down here for, that it's my flock of 20-something tattooed pagans. But they welcome me, and, you know, I'm not down here. I tell them at the beginning, if I can be supportive of them, if I can walk through this with them, that's great. I am not here to sell them Bibles or give them away. And I'm not here to convert people in any way other than what Pope Francis says, which is that if I live the joy of the gospel, then I'm doing the priesthood right. The point of it is not evangelization. It's walking with people.
So. I appreciate that. That's just remarkable. I know that one of your particular bents is people's ethical behavior. Could you tell me a little bit about how you regard the ethical responsibility of both the bartender and the cocktail drinker?
Sure. I'll tell you what I tell my students, right? So I deal with students from the age of 18 to 22 at Notre Dame, and as you might imagine, not all of them respect the law of the state of Indiana, which says that they need to be 21 when they drink. And as you might imagine, the 18 and 19-year-old and 20-year-old drinkers that I sometimes have to help to see some light, they don't have very good taste in booze either. So I tell them that their taste and their maturity need to grow swiftly, right? You need to think about who you want to be at midnight and plan to be that person. And if what you want to be at midnight is not someone you'd be proud to be, well, that's when you go out and buy a plastic bottle of something that doesn't taste very good and down as much of it as quickly as you can, hiding it with things that taste better to you than whatever's in that plastic bottle. That is the misuse and the abuse of alcohol to lead you away from who you want to be as your best self, right? Wine that gladdens the heart is, you know, a cocktail shared with friends that certainly warms the spirit. I'm not saying there's no effect of alcohol on the system, right? And that's a part of what is good about it when it's used responsibly to build friendship, to build community. So I try to get people to think about that.
Father Bill, give us an overview of how you see spirits and spirituality going hand in hand.
Well, there were two points we tried to make in a panel that we did on that I mentioned earlier. Derek Brown and Eric Seed and some of the other presenters talked about the history from the earliest times, people who believed in God, one God or another, and who discovered that that fruit rotting over in the corner actually was fermenting and that there was something profound, something that warmed the heart about that alcohol. It began to be incorporated into religious rituals. It's not accidental that wine is the first miracle in the Gospel of John. There was something that warmed the heart at that wedding at Cana, and that was a foreshadowing of what for Catholics and other Christians is the Eucharist, right? Communion, bread and wine. My contribution to that panel was to think more broadly about hospitality. And what I tried to make was the following point, which is think about why people come into a church. They've moved to a new town and they want community. They come to a church because someone has died and they want consolation. They come to a church because they've gotten engaged and they want to celebrate and solemnize what they've just done and plan for a wedding. They come to a church because they're feeling lost. Why do people show up at a bar in some city they may not have lived in? They want to find community and communion. They may have had a bad day and they need some consolation. They may have gotten a scary medical result. They may have just gotten engaged and they want to go celebrate and buy everyone a round of bubbles. Precisely the same things that bring people into a church and into my line of work bring people into a bar seeking hospitality. And what a bartender does, what a priest does when we are doing our jobs well, is to create a space for people who are hurting, who are lonely, who are celebrating, and that's a ministry of hospitality. And so I think, as I said earlier, it's fair to say that there is a commonality of professions between these bartenders and myself, and they are caring professions at their very best, and they help people to feel a little bit more comfortable in the world.
Father Bill, it was a blessing to have you join us on Louisiana Eats, and I'm honored to have met you. And I hope you'll check in with us and come back and see us again.
Anytime. It was a pleasure to be here and a lovely conversation. Thank you.
Father Bill Dailey of the Congregation of Holy Cross. While there are many holiday drink traditions, like eggnog and hot toddies or mulled wine and hard cider, one drink you've probably never heard of is Perry. This traditional alcoholic beverage is made from fermented pears and created in a process similar to how cider is made from apples. Here to talk about Perry and how you can make Perry in your own backyard is author Debbie Teashon. Debbie, welcome to Louisiana Eats.
Hello.
A lot of modern commercial Perrys are referred to as pear cider, and we want to make sure our Louisiana Eats listeners know the difference when they go to select something. What is the difference, or why are you not fond of the term pear cider?
Well, the pear cider is just that. It is a cider, and it is different than Perry. And once you've tasted the difference, you don't want to go back to pear cider if you love the Perry, because the Perry is a very light, very delicate taste that a cider does not have. And traditionally, a Perry is just made from Perry pears.
Debbie, could you tell me, what's the difference between a pear tree and a Perry tree? Seems to me like they should be the same thing.
Well, they're both pears. It's like the difference between a cider apple and a dessert apple tree. You would not want to eat a Perry pear. It is very terrible tasting.
Well, I can only imagine that you wouldn't have written this book for the home gardener if you didn't have some sort of little mini orchard of Perry trees in your backyard. So what have you got growing back there?
All you need in your backyard orchard to make a good Perry is one Perry tree. You also need a pollinator, and that could be a dessert pear that you can cook with or eat fresh.
Is this something that's very difficult to make at home?
It's not difficult, but you do need to pay attention to details with it, and it takes about 10 months from the time you harvest to the time that you are able to utilize it.
Well, go ahead and walk us through the process. I imagine it all starts off, first, you pick the pears off the Perry tree.
Correct. And once you've picked them, then you need to have the pears rest for a few days. You store them in a single layer. And just like you would with your dessert pears, they need to come to full ripeness. And you want to pick about 20 pounds, and that'll give you a gallon of Perry. You don't want to wash the pears, because then you'll wash off the wild yeast, which helps in the fermentation. The next step is you mash them, or you put them in like the apple press and crush it. And it's not called a pulp. At that point, it's called a pumice. So then after the rest, you cover the pumice with cheesecloth, and you leave it in a cool place overnight to help release the tannins.
Do you strain them before the fermentation begins?
No, you just put them right into your fermentation bucket or your glass carboil, and then leave the container open so it can breathe. And then the fermentation takes about a day or two to start and takes several weeks for it to complete. And then after that, you rack it off into a sterile container, and that takes about 6 months in a cool place, normally done over winter, in a place where it will stay cool and not freeze. And then you bottle it.
So do you have any idea if it's possible to grow pear trees in the South?
Well, if you can grow any kind of pear tree, you can grow a pear tree. They have about the same requirements.
Well, Debbie, thank you so much for finally giving the pear the respect it deserves and for sharing your knowledge on pear. Thank you, Debbie.
And thank you for having me.
Debbie Teashon, co-author of Gardening for the Home Brewer, available in bookstores everywhere. Now that you all know about pear, an ingredient that's still pretty hard to come by, let's talk about cooking with cider. Right now, grocery stores are filled with this year's crop of fresh cider, and there's a lot more to do with that delicious annual ingredient than just drink it. Let's start with breakfast. Try using fresh cider instead of water when you cook those old-fashioned steel-cut rolled oats. But be forewarned, you may never want to cook them with water ever again. Also, substitute cider for the water called for in pancake mixes to see what a delightful surprise that is. And then, instead of maple syrup, top those pancakes with applesauce. Yum! Cider is a fabulous liquid for braising everything from domestic chickens and ducks to wild boar. And use it to braise your root vegetables, like carrots, parsnips, turnips, and rutabagas. The gentle sweetness works its way into the meats and vegetables, adding a special touch of fall goodness. That goes for stews, too. Substitute cider for stock and wine in your next lamb stew, and see how transformative that can be. And the next time that damp, wintry weather gets into your bones, heat some cider with cinnamon and cloves, then spike it with a big shot of rum or whiskey. It's an instant hot toddy. I'm Poppy Tooker, and you're listening to Louisiana Eats. How do you avoid getting your guests too inebriated at your holiday party this year? Stay tuned. And we have some good advice for you about that when we come right back.
Dada, Blitzen, Dasher, Dancer, Prancer, Vixen!
I'm Poppy Tooker, and you're listening to Louisiana Eats, edible content for Louisiana food lovers. Louisiana Eats is made possible with major support from Rouse's Markets. Here's this week's culinary quiz question, brought to you with support from Popeye's Louisiana Culinary Institute. How do you avoid getting your guests too inebriated at your holiday party this year? First, have some non-alcoholic drink options, like a punch with no alcohol, that alcohol could be added to at the guest's discretion. It would surprise you how many people will choose to drink the unspiked punch while appearing to party with the best of them. Make sure there's ample water, both still and sparkling, easily accessible to guests.
Making a habit of drinking a glass of water between each cocktail makes a huge difference in alcohol consumption. And for goodness sake, encourage designated drivers. And remember, there's always a safe ride home in a taxi. I'm Poppy Tooker, and I want your holiday season to be both a happy and a safe one.
I'm David Scott Solmonson. I'm the co-author of 12 Bottle Bar, which I wrote with my lovely wife here.
And I'm the lovely wife, Lesley Jacob Solmonson, also co-author that I wrote the book 12 Bottle Bar with my lovely husband.
Whether you're a cocktail connoisseur or just have a casual interest in mixed drinks, Lesley Jacob Solmonson and David Scott Solmonson would like you to get the most out of your cocktail experience. Their book, 12 Bottle Bar, offers hundreds of recipes, tips on how to throw your own cocktail party, and a new way to think about drinking.
There's two things I really want to achieve with this book and sort of with the mission we're on. One is to wipe light beer off the have people over to your house menu. If you ride a Harley and you drink light beer, we need to have a talk.
Because and, we want to go riding with them, right?
Correct. And well, the other thing is we really would like to, with the cocktail renaissance, the one thing we haven't really seen so much is the resurgence of the cocktail party. And we'd like to have people go, you know, it's not that difficult to make something like a Tom Collins punch. And you make it in advance of your party. And then your friends come over and they serve themselves. And you do what you're supposed to do, which is be with your friends and not being trying to impress them by, you know, how great you can make a blue blazer.
And one of the messages of the book truly is that cocktails are no mystery. Going to a bar is a very different experience than making drinks at home, either for yourself or for your friends. You go to a bar to treat yourself and to indulge, not only in ingredients that can be esoteric or can be something you might not normally try, you're not even sure how to handle it or mix with it, but you're excited and you want to see what a bartender can surprise you with. I think that's the new nature of the cocktail culture, and bartenders flourish when you give them that permission. But by the same token, you don't want to take that time to make things at home that are that complex. You want to make a well-made drink that you can customize and that has certain elements of whimsy, perhaps, or something like that. But being at home and drinking is a very different experience. In some ways, it's more intimate, and it's great for us. I mean, we can make a drink in 3 minutes in the kitchen, and it's fun, and, you know, oh, God, I squirted lemon in my eye. Oh, here, can you do this? Versus 20 minutes cooking dinner, even.
I can cook. You can cook. We can all cook. There's a big difference between saying we can cook and saying we're Grant Achatz or we're Thomas Keller. And I think that's the difference we see for the home bartender and the professional bartender. So from that perspective, and we like to use the food analogies a lot, is we really want to provide people with that great spaghetti and meatballs. We want to provide them with that great meatloaf or, you know, the fried chicken. So these staples that everybody feels comfortable, or everybody's got a dish they make. We want everybody to have a cocktail that they make. And I think one of the fears that most people have of cocktails is not understanding them. People go to a bar and they don't know what a Tom Collins is, and they don't really know what they want to drink. So they order something that they sound intelligent, you know, like I'll have a Grey Goose and soda. And they do it just out of panic and fear, I think, in a lot of cases, or just comfort. And I think if you get people to a point where they're like, you know, I like a whiskey sour, but I like it with rosemary syrup instead of regular simple syrup, and it's easy to make at home, and I can throw that together, that's where we want to help people get to.
So you think you might want to give home bartending a try? Where do you begin? Lesley and David explain how 12 Bottle Bar allows readers to acquaint themselves with their liquor cabinet using one bottle at a time.
We start with the one bottle bar. One is just pick a spirit you like. And quite frankly, I don't care if it's a spirit that's in the book or not, but mix it with some sugar, some citrus, go to town. Find ways to explore with different citruses, with different sugars, with a little bit of water. You know, make a Tom Collins, make a grog, make things like this that were the foundations of cocktails anyway. And I tend to like to follow that historic path. How did these things evolve over time? Well, let's evolve our education the same way.
And our bar. So if you're a complete neophyte, this is a way to sort of handhold you and say, drink what you like. You don't have to restrict yourself, even if it's not on our list, as David said, and you go with a basic. Then with the three bottle bar, we go to our next cocktail level where you can actually make a true mixed drink.
We add the vermouth and bitters at that point, what we call the salt and pepper, again, food analogies for us. bitters are more in the spice rack category, but we want to convey to people that things like the way you would add salt to a steak to bring, or to any meal to bring out the flavors, you're not seasoning something to make it salty. You're not adding bitters to make something bitter, per se. You're adding it to enhance the other flavors. So that's our three-bottle bar. So your space spirit, pick a bottle of bitters, pick a vermouth that you like. Make a Manhattan, make a martini, but just begin to learn how these things play together.
And
then
all in, if you were to do, say, those three bottles on the low end, you'd spend maybe $20. And you'd have your own little bar with
20,
your favorites.
20 to 40 based on what
you're
buying.
Well, depending on how high-end. If you have an expensive taste in whiskey, then yes, perhaps more. But if we're looking at the low end of our actual cost, because we do low-end spirits and artisan spirits, yeah, $25, $30, and you've got your own little custom bar that you can make, you know, 20 or so drinks with.
And then we go to the four-bottle bar, which is simply adding liqueur. And in the book, we basically specify orange liqueur. We like Cointreau above all others just because it's super, super bright and clean in its orange flavor. It's super clear, so it doesn't muddy other things. And again, to go back to food analogies, I think it was Stephen Reichlin or somebody who I learned from that when you make a rub, don't put salt in your rub. Add the salt separately so you can control the level of saltiness. And something like Cointreau, if you use brandy-based orange liqueurs or things with a lot of other flavors, well, they're going to bring all those flavors along with them. So again, a clean spirit or a clean flavor that you can apply specifically and surgically, that I like that.
Yeah, and Cointreau also is sugar-based, so that becomes a sweetener. And sugar is something that a lot of people are really afraid of because you think of cocktails and most people think, oh, it's spirit heavier, oh, it's bitter. But cocktails do, a great number of them need that element of sugar in them. And I don't mean a spoonful of sugar. I mean some sort of element that, again, brings everything into balance. You know, the ABV of the spirit, your actual percentages of alcohol, your citrus levels, which are your tartness, the sweetness of whatever sweetener you're using. So all of the things we have do that.
For me, a well-made cocktail is a war of ingredients that no side wins. You want that constant interplay. You want everything to come out. You want to taste the spirit. If you lose the spirit, what's the point in drinking it? If you lose the citrus or you lose the sugar, it should be sweet enough so it's not too sour. It should be sour enough so it's not too sweet.
Taste is exceedingly subjective. The drink I like is not the drink you like. It's not the drink any of us like because it's affected by memory. It's affected by what we've read. It's affected by our own taste buds.
The pretty girl you were drinking it next to.
That's right. Could have been the worst drink in the world, but boy, you remember that whatever it was, right?
And one thing we really wanted to do with the book is we had to find a way to make ourselves different. You know, the 12-bottle bar concept is, sure, that's one thing, but one goal we really had in putting the book together is we wanted to put a cocktail party in book form. So there's a linear path through the book. You read the chapters, the one bottle bar, three bottle bar, you read about the bottles and the drinks you can make. But we wanted this sort of parallel nonlinear path, which is if you're walking through a party, the conversations you might pick up. So, you know, we have people like Dale DeGroff and David Wondrich and a lot of, you know, up-and-coming bartenders as well. And then people like Mike Nelson from Mystery Science Theater telling about his days working at a TGI Fridays. And those are the kind of things I want somebody to be able to flip open the book, or we want somebody, and turn to a page and go, oh, there's something interesting to read here. So it's not just a recipe book. We want people to actually read it.
Well, I am so thrilled that you all took the time to talk with us on Louisiana Eats. You have really written a very special, very unusual book that I think everybody who drinks at home should have at home. So thank you.
We hope they think so. We enjoyed writing
it. Bobby, thank you for having us.
Yes, thank you.
Kind of you to say. Thank you.
Lesley Jacob Solmonson and David Scott Solmonson, authors of 12 Bottle Bar. That's it for this week's edition of Louisiana Eats, edible content for Louisiana food lovers. Join us next week when we have a visit with Temple Sinai's Rabbi Cohen to talk Hanukkah and the traditional potato latke.
There's very little in Jewish dietary life which is calorically lean. We really do a job on ourselves.
Subscribe to our podcast, hear today's show, or catch up on previous editions anytime online at itsneworleans.com. Louisiana Eats is made possible with major support from Popeye's Louisiana Kitchen, Rouse's Markets, and Zatarain's. Additional support for Louisiana Eats is provided by the Shreveport-Bossier Convention and Tourist Bureau and by Tableau.
Dickie Brennan's latest restaurant, serving local Creole cuisine with a view of Jackson Square. Original theme music by Johnny Sketch and the Dirty Notes. Big thanks to producers Joe Schreiner and Sarah Holtz. Come visit us anytime in our Louisiana Eats studio at the Southern Food and Beverage Museum. I'm Poppy Tooker. Louisiana Eats is a production of WWNO and the University of New Orleans.